So this is about national infrastructure pipeline. So this is one of the important key initiative of the government that is very much in the news because of the finance minister announcement. And then even before that, Prime Minister Modi announced that he's going to invest 100 lakh, about 100 lakh crore rupees in infrastructure in Independence Day speech in 2019. So that's why this is very, very important for this year. So kindly see the question. Consider the following statement with respect to national infrastructure project or national infrastructure pipeline that was in the news. So first one, national infrastructure pipeline is proposed to stimulate infrastructure push in a big way with 111 lakh crores projects covering the period 2019 to 2025. And second one, NIP is intended to push for greenfield projects. And third one, the center and states are expected to have almost equal share in implementing NIP, while the private sector contribution is expected to be around 21%. The solution is here. The second statement is wrong, actually. So NIP, this infrastructure pipeline, is basically not just for the greenfield projects, but even for the brownfield projects also. So it covers both greenfield and brownfield. So that's why the second statement is wrong here. And the rest one and three are correct. So earlier it was proposed with 103 lakh crores, and then it was expanded to about 111 lakh crores. And the time period is also very important. It is from 2019 to 25. Why this 25? Because by the time they want to make India 5 trillion economy. So one of the tools they are using to make India 5 trillion economy is by going for this large infrastructure push. Okay, this way the government is going to spend most of this money. And the third one is correct. It is basically they are expecting private also to be entering in this, for example, in the roadways or railways. So they are inviting private investments. So that contribution is about 21% and 21 to 22. And the rest, it is 39 and 39, center 39 and state 39. So that is how they have divided. So now we'll see this in detail. So you can see here the answer is C. Yeah, so the context, as I said, there are two things. One, there was a task force formed on this project basically to select the projects which can be included in this national infrastructure pipeline. So pipeline as a word, that means it is basically that is in the planning or in the processing stage. So they want to pick up certain projects and want to implement it in this 2019-25 period. So Modi promised, and then a task force was set up, and it has recommended to increase this investment to about 111 lakh crores. And as I said already, it is about one of the tool to achieve 5 trillion by 24-25. So you can remember the target years also by that way. And another important thing here is that you have to focus on is it's based on ease of living. So these projects are mainly, their main objective is to improve ease of living of India. Because Modi presented this vision, New India vision, in that ease of living, like ease of doing business, is what he presented. So what is there in this ease of living? That is, he wants to provide safe drinking water, access to clean and affordable energy, healthcare for all, and modern railway stations, airports, bus terminals, and world-class educational institutions. So all of these are basically sustainable development targets. So basically, he wants to focus on both economic infrastructure projects and social infrastructure projects. So here, social infrastructure projects are something like educational institutions, drinking water, these kind of things, health, are fall under educational, social infrastructure projects. Whereas roads, railways, ports fall under economic infrastructure projects. So kindly remember that this NIP is for both, not just for economic. Because usually infrastructure, we usually try to associate that with only roads and railways. But this one is both, social and economic. And next important feature is, it covers both greenfield and brownfield. Now, greenfield, you all know, if any project that has been started from scratch, then you call it as greenfield. Brownfield means already there is a project and now you want to expand it. Or already if there is a company and you want to expand it, then it falls under brownfield. So it covers both. And finally, the contribution share. The important areas that form majority part of this project are energy, roads, railways, and urban projects. So they constitute about 70%, and rest of the projects fall under the 30%. In this, we have already seen the formula, like 39, 39, and 22. So here 39 is center, 39 is state, and 21 to 22 from private. So this is a contribution they are expecting in this fund. And finally, right now, till now in this pipeline, 40% of the projects are under implementation, 30% are in conceptual stage, and 20% are under development. So this is the status. This is okay even if you don't remember, but remember these kind of features like the period, where it is targeting, like social and economic infrastructure, SDG targets, and then greenfield and brownfield. And then finally, what is the contribution of state, center, and private sector? That is enough. Okay, now we'll see the next one. So this is a question that I said I have just picked verbatim from the UPSC 2019. So this was a surprise question for many of the people. So actual question was, why is a plant named Prosperous Juliforia often mentioned in the news? This was basically, these kind of technical terms sometimes might appear tricky and it is very difficult to even guess because options are also very close. But this is how even UPSC also gives certain questions. So that's why to prepare you for that, I'm giving this question. So basically here, Senna spectabilis is an invasive species. So when you say invasive species, which option suits it very well in this? It is basically B. So B is the one. It tends to reduce the biodiversity in the area which it grows. So that is Senna spectabilis. Similarly, Prosperous Juliforia is also an invasive species. So sometimes whenever there is an invasive species appearing in news constantly, try to know the scientific name as well. Okay. And it's very easy to remember them when you see the picture of it. And you'll surprise to know this. These two plants, you already know their Telugu names and you might have seen them on the road also. I'll show those pictures also now. So the answer here is basically B. And first, let me show that. See, on the left side, you have right. So that is nothing but left and right. Both are called Tummichettu, okay? And the right one in Telugu is called Sarkar Tummichettu. And the left one is Metta Tummidichettu, okay? Something like that. And the down one is water hyacinth. So this is also very, very important invasive species. This water hyacinth is mainly found in lakes and water bodies. So once it gets established in a water body, the fishes will not get enough oxygen. The dissolved oxygen levels will drop. And similarly, no other organisms, marine organisms, flourish under it because no sunlight can penetrate and it consumes all the oxygen. So that's why these invasive species are very, very important. So try to remember them by seeing the pictures. So the right one here, it is Prosperous Juliforia, then is Senna spectabilis, and this is water hyacinth. Now we'll see, after seeing this visual pictures, we'll see the actual information about it. So the reason why it was in news is basically Kerala government trying to fight or trying to prevent this invasive species called Senna spectabilis in the Nilgiris Biosphere Reserve. And usually why this happened is because there are a number of bamboo species in this forest in the Nilgiri, and they have dried up. And this space is occupied by these species. And these invasive species' speciality is that they can thrive in any environment. Even in the hostile environment, they can thrive. And another feature is they will dominate the entire ecosystem. So that's how they'll kill the other species. So that is what you can see here, even in the definition. Invasive alien species are species whose introduction or spread outside their natural past or present distribution threatens biological diversity. So that is what happens. So when it threatens biological diversity outside its natural habit, then it is called as an invasive species. And the main characteristics, this is also try to remember, of an invasive species are, first one, rapid reproduction and growth. Second one, high dispersal ability. And third one, phenotypic plasticity. That means ability to adapt physiologically to new conditions and ability to survive on various food types. So this term is very, very important. This is again an environment technical term, that is phenotypic plasticity. So phenotypic plasticity means phenotype is and characteristics of a plant or any species. Phenotype, that is a characteristic. And now plasticity means that elasticity or flexibility of that plant to survive in any condition. Like it can survive in heavy rain kind of ecosystem and also in a desert kind of ecosystem. Then you call it as phenotypic plasticity. So if it has these conditions, phenotypic and rapid reproduction and high dispersal ability, then you call it as an invasive species. So try to remember them because sometimes they might give these conditions and say which species can satisfy all these three conditions. And then in the options, they might give something like invasive and then alien species, extra options and all. So part of this, we'll see three invasive species that are in the news. So first is Senna spectabilis. So basically, it was a deciduous tree that is native to tropical areas of America. That is Northern America. That is about Southern USA and Mexico and Caribbean islands. So it used to grow there in the drought desert areas. But unfortunately, it is now become an important issue in India, because in India also you have same conditions like less rainfall and all. And these species have long roots to even get the groundwater. So they can tap the groundwater also. That is how they survive. And that is how they are spreading. And you can see all this, like right now it is in the least concern and all. So basically that is Senna spectabilis. And the next thing is Prosopis juliforia. This also was native to Mexico and Southern America and Caribbean. And this you all know, like wherever the wastelands are there, that entire area will be covered by this plant. And the important, another drastic effect is, it is one of the important contributing factor for malaria. Why? Because there are certain water feeders in their plant parts. Like this plant has certain parts like seeds, fruits and all. In that, the water content is huge. And these malaria basically grow in them by feeding on those water. So that's how it is being sourced to malaria as well. And then water hyacinth, you all know, it is basically a free floating aquatic plant. And it is also native to South America, basically the Amazon area and all. And now it has become an invasive in all the wetlands, like even in the Hyderabad rivers or lakes, wherever you are nearby, you can see this. And it is also the another nickname for this is Terror of Bengal. This also remember. Sometimes they use these kind of words, Terror of Bengal, because in Kolkata, there are many these things like water Ramsar sites, like East Kolkata wetlands and all these wetlands are occupied by these species, and they have threatened many of them ecosystems, like the fishes availability, ecosystem and all. So that's why it is called Terror of Bengal. And another feature is like it can duplicate in 9 days, like it almost doubles in every 9 days. That is why it spreads very fast. And it has effect in dams also, where the hydroelectric generation potential will be affected. Even boats cannot go further. So that's why navigation problems are also there. And finally, I would advise you to read about Amazon catfish. So this is also kind of an alien species which was discovered after Kerala floods. So this is a fish which is not used for food purposes, but it is trying to reproduce rapidly and threatening the ecosystem of other native fishes. So kindly see this catfish. And there are certain laws which we use to control invasive alien species. So kindly refer to them as well, like the Biological Diversity Act, Environment Protection Act, and then Livestock Importation Act, because under this you will give certain licenses and prohibit certain plants from importing. And then similarly, you have destructive insects and pests. Under this, even our locust will also fall under. And then you have plant quarantine, where if you are importing certain plants, then you have to take separate licenses and you have to follow certain procedures and all. So try to see at least a brief overview about these acts, because these are also sometimes important. I will go with the next one. Okay, so third one, the Russian-led collective defensive based organization that works on the principle that any attack on one member is treated as attack on all, refers to which of the following organization? First one, United Nations Peacekeeping Force. Second one, the Collective Security Treaty Organization. Third one, North Atlantic Treaty Organization, aka NATO. And then Shanghai Cooperation Organization. So kindly mark your answer, but carefully read the question once again and then mark your answer, because there are certain kind of traps in this. Right answer here, it is B, Collective Security Treaty Organization. Here mainly the trap was with respect to NATO, because we usually see in the news and all talking about this, any attack on one member is treated as attack on all from the perspective of NATO. But exactly replica of NATO is Collective Security Treaty Organization. So it is an exact replica by Russia. So the problem here is, in the question I said Russia led. So that is where you can differentiate whether it is NATO or CSTO. So here the option is CSTO. And actually the NATO was very much in use, but I framed this in CSTO, and we'll see all these organizations in detail because these are very, very important from this year point of view. And first of all, why NATO was in use? NATO was in use because there are two things. First, Donald Trump has asked, you know, all the members of the NATO to increase their defense spending. If not, he threatened US will move out of NATO. And second thing, French president also said NATO is currently suffering a brain death. So this has brought NATO into focus. Like all of them started questioning, is there any relevance? Because NATO was formed as an organization to contain or to an opposition to Russia. And now there is no Cold War, no Soviet Russia, and Russia is no more a threat. But actual threat for US and some of the other nations is China. So that is why US is also refocusing its attention from NATO to other members. That's why NATO is very much in news. So now we will see about NATO. NATO is basically based or created on the basis of Washington Treaty in 1949, just after World War II. So just after World War II, you all know the tensions have risen between West and East, and then a part of the Cold War. What US did is US has atomic bomb, and Russia, Soviet Russia had atomic bomb. So to avoid other nations from getting it and to secure all the other European nations under US, US extended its nuclear bomb facility or capability to all these nations under this organization called NATO. So basically, it is a security or military alliance. And the main principle, it is Article 5 that says if one member of the alliance is attacked in Europe or in North America, it is considered to be attack on all the members. So all will together reply back to that. So that is the basis. And in opposition to this, Russia created Warsaw Pact first. And when it dissolved, Soviet Union got dissolved in 1991, then Russia formed Collective Security Treaty Organization in 2002, around 2001. Okay, so this is about NATO. Another thing you have to remember is NATO headquarters is in basically Brussels in Belgium. And another thing, this Article 5, that one attack against any member is treated as attack on all, is first applied for attack on US in September 11, it is. Okay, so that is bombings of World Trade Center. And the final latest update is that Republic of Macedonia, you have to locate this country in the map, kindly see this country. Okay, this country name was changed to Republic of North Macedonia, basically to gain entry into NATO and European Union, because Greece is a country which is opposing to this name, because this Macedonia is an area from where Alexander came and started all these invasions. Okay, so that's why they want to own this heritage. If Macedonia is the name of a country, then Greece thinks that Alexander heritage will be gone to Macedonia. So that's why it said, until unless you don't change your name of the country, I won't accept you to join NATO or EU. Because in NATO and EU, all the members have to agree. So that's why Greece has certain veto power. So to avoid this and to join, Republic of Macedonia changed its name to Republic of North Macedonia. So this happened in 2018-19, and this is very, very, very important. You have to see all the bordering countries of Republic of North Macedonia. One is Greece. You have several other Balkan states. Okay, you have to see that, and you also have to see what are the seas beside it. Like Adriatic Sea is there on the left, and then on the right you have Mediterranean Sea. Okay, so try to see this seas as well, like where it is in geographic area. Very, very important from this year. And then you have United Nations Peacekeeping Force. So this you all know, while this one is based on collective defense principle, UNPKF is basically based on collective security. So this is one difference. That is collective defense. This is collective security. That is the main difference. And second thing, it is official organ of UN, basically, okay, to enforce peace. And it started its first operation with 1948 Arab-Israel war. And UN peacekeeping is guided by three main principles. This also you have to remember. One, the consent of the parties. If there are parties that are going for war or they are in the conflict, that parties have to definitely agree for UNPKF. Second thing, the UN PKF should be impartial. Okay. And third thing, there shouldn't be any use of force by UN PKF until unless they were on the defense side or they were threatened by other side. That is UN PKF. And you all know India is one of the top troop contributors to UN peacekeeping missions. Then you have CSTO. CSTO is nothing but same thing. It's just an intergovernmental military alliance, but says try to know the members. Okay. Members are very important. Here the members are erstwhile Soviet Union members. Basically Belarus, Armenia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and Russia and Tajikistan. So just try to see what are the members that are not there in this. What are the Central Asian countries that are not there in CSTO? That way it will be easy to remember. For example, is Turkmenistan in this? It is not there. So if you they given the option, then it is easy for you to eliminate. Because Central Asia, you all know, like Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, Kyrgyzstan, these are all the countries. So all the Central Asian countries and the countries that are bordering Russia are members of CSTO. Only eliminate Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, and Azerbaijan. These are the only three countries that are not there from Central Asia. This way you can better remember this. And this is based on Tashkent Charter. NATO is based on Washington Agreement. Okay, this way remember. And this is also same principle. Like if one attack, one member, if any gun attacks one member, then all can reply back. And then you have finally SCO, Shanghai Cooperation Organization. This is also very, very important for this year. Because from the time India joined SCO in 2017, we didn't had any question on this SCO. So there might be a question either in prelims or in mains. So this also, you know, it is basically an intergovernmental organization and it combines Eurasia, Europe and Asia. And basically first it was Shanghai 5, where China, Russia and three countries of Central Asia were there. And then it was expanded to total of 8 members, including India and Pakistan. So in 2017, India and Pakistan became members. And this you all know, it was created in 2001 and the official languages are Russian and Chinese as of now. Okay, and there was another slide, I guess, that was missing. So I will talk about it. So SCO has certain structure. So in that structure, you have head of the states meeting and then head of the government's meeting. And there is regional anti-terrorist structure. That is very, very important. Okay, RATS. RATS is for anti-terrorism. And you have to know where it is based. So, okay. So kindly try to search where RATS headquartered is. That is very important. And you have SCO headquartered. That is also important. Try to know where is SCO headquarter and RATS headquarter. These are the only two things that are important about SCO and the members. Okay. And they also conduct every year annual military exercises, anti-counterterrorism exercises. So try to know where it was conducted in last year. This is because last year for the first time India in the history for the first time participated with Pakistan in a military exercise. That's why it was very important. So that is about SCO. So now the fourth question, this is also a bit easy. So with which of the following country US is pursuing maximum pressure policy that was seen constantly in news? So this is a kind of typical UPSC type of framing the question. Okay. Either you know this fact or you don't know. So kindly mark your answer and then we'll see. Because with all of these countries right now, US is having some kind of disputes or getting out of there. So the answer here is basically it is Iran. Okay, maximum pressure is with respect to Iran. Okay, and North Korea, you have separate policies like with respect to nuclear nuclear denuclearization is for North Korea, and cutting the terrorism support is for Pakistan. Afghanistan, you all know, peace deal or peace process, US Taliban peace process. So this was maximum pressure. So basically in maximum pressure, what happens is US is trying to put the maximum pressure for Iran to abide by the not only nuclear agreements, but also to stop terrorism activities. Basically what Iran is doing is it is trying to spread terrorism by supporting proxy groups. For example, in Yemen, it is participating through Houthi rebels. Okay, remember this, Houthi rebels always belong to Yemen. And similarly in Lebanon, it is Hezbollah with Yemen. This pairing is also very important for you to remember. So Iran is supporting Hezbollah in Lebanon and Syria. In Syria also, there were certain Shia militants and then As I said, in Yemen, it is Houthi rebels. And similarly, in Iraq also, there are Shia militants. That's why it is supporting. So US is trying to put not only sanctions, but it is trying to put the pressure on all the countries not to do business with Iran. So that way, it is putting maximum pressure. One thing, to change Iran policies with respect to nuclear. Second, terrorism. And third thing, it is also set to aim at changing the government or regime in Iran. So this is maximum pressure policy of US with respect to Iran. Fifth question. So this is again very, very important thing. So right now also it is in use. So consider the following statement with respect to Miyawaki forest being adopted by many states. Okay. First one, Miyawaki forest involve multi-layered saplings planting close to each other. Second one, in this Miyawaki forest, trees are intended to grow vertically rather than horizontally by factoring sunlight for this purpose. Third one, Miyawaki forests are most suited for mountainous and temperate climate countries like Japan. So this is a kind of tricky question. So kindly read this. And if someone is reading even Telugu newspaper, they would have already got an idea about this, because this is very much associated with even Telangana government scheme. So kindly mark your answer and then we'll see. So here the first and second statements are absolutely true, because this is in Telugu called as Chittadivilu basically. Okay. And this is part of our Haritaharam. So in Telangana, in Haritaharam, they are trying to create these kind of forests in less amount of space in urban areas and also in certain degraded areas in towns and villages. So that is why this is very, very, very important. And this is not only Telangana that is adopting this style. Even Kerala has adopted, Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu also have adopted before Telangana. And it is one of the successful model of developing like very natural replica kind of forest. That's why this method is very, very important. So we will see this in detail. So here basically one and two are correct, but the third statement is wrong, because if it is something suited for only Japan, then it wouldn't have been tried in India. So basically it is a universal model. It can be tried anywhere. So now we'll see this in detail. So this, as I said, Telangana government is trying to do this and all. And the Miyawaki process is basically developed by a Japanese botanist or plant expert called Akira Miyawaki. Okay. He is the one who invented this technique. You don't need to remember the name. Just for your information, I've provided this. So the basic process is like, they will divide the trees in four categories or four layers. That is shrub, subtree, tree, and canopy. So what they do is they plant these divided saplings in layers. Like first they plant shrubs, and then they plant subtree, and then tree and canopy. So what happens is basically, the trees which are vertically long, they will receive the first sunlight, and then the shrubs doesn't need that much sunlight. They can manage with this. So in this way, by vertical categorization, the forest will be very, very thick. It will be so much thick that even sunlight cannot penetrate into the bottom of forest. So if you are growing only one kind of variety in the forest, for example, only trees, then it will be difficult to grow it in a thick variety. That means it cannot be very thick, not very dense, because you all know like trees, when they will compete for sunlight. But if you use different varieties need different amounts of sunlight. Like for example, tall trees need certain sunlight, and they will let certain amount of sunlight to fall on subtrees. Subtrees will give some more sunlight to fall on shrubs, and then substrubs and shrubs. And shrubs need very less amount of sunlight. So every plant can grow equally in this. So this is a kind of approach they do it. So that is what is explained here. Like, and in this multi-layered, another feature is the saplings are planted very close to each other. Okay. This blocks sunlight from reaching the ground and prevents weeds from also growing. This is another benefit. Like there will not be any weeds, thus keeping the soil moist. And the close cropping further ensures the plant receives sunlight only from the top, thus enabling them to grow upwards than sideways. So this is what I said, vertical growth rather than horizontal growth. So this way you can benefit more carbon sequestration. That is also important from climate change. And growing the saplings close also ensures space for most trees to be planted. That means in less area, you can plant more trees. This is what we need, right? Right now in India, you all know the population is more and we have less amount of land for forests. So this is what we can do. Like, and we can plant more trees and less amount of land. And the advantage is, sir, first thing, this is kind of concept which was successful with replicating about 3,000 forests around the world. So it is the most successful model. Second thing, you can grow these kind of forests in 22 to 30 years, which if you see natural forest to grow, it takes around 200 years. This is an actual model of tropical rainforest. Even if you see in a tropical rainforest, there will be tall trees and then medium trees, and then you have grasslands and shrubs. So this is a kind of concept they are trying to replicate in less time. That is another advantage. And the third advantage is it grows 10 times faster and 30 times denser, because no plant competes with other plant. Everything will have different needs. So that's how they grow faster. And you can see the stats as well, like 30 times better CO2 absorption capacity, 30 times better noise, because in urban areas, if you have these kind of forests in the exteriors, in the surroundings, then you can prevent noise pollution also, because these are very densely packed. And then you have dust reduction capability for air pollution and all. So all these are important advantages. And another important unique feature is, like, you need to nurse them for only 2 years. After 2 years, they can grow on their own because they don't rely on any external support. This is because as they are very close, the moisture on the ground is so much. So they will get this extra water, and they will also be helpful in recharging groundwater. So these are the advantages of these Miyawaki forests. That is why every government is now trying to grow these forests in their states, part of covering 33% target of forests. So this is a diagram. You can see those are saplings that are planted in layers and they're grown. And then now the sixth question, this is very much related to both right now what is happening with respect to corona vaccine development and also with respect to the event that happened in January first week of 2020. So consider the following statements with respect to different types of vaccines. So first one, conjugate vaccines are made of weakened live microbes that are released in the body, generating a response from the immune system. Second one, live attenuated vaccines developed out of specific parts of the microbe, say a protein or sugar molecule, etc. And third one, in a vaccine development stages, phase one is to test efficacy of vaccine and phase two is to test safety of the vaccine. Okay, so kindly mark your answer. Already the answer is visible, I believe. So many of you would have already noticed. If not, then I will tell anyway. So this is something you can even mark by having a common awareness. Right now, if you watch even TV, you would have already got the answer for this. Okay. So here, basically, kindly see the one which is not confusing. First, focus on third, because third is something which is constantly news. Okay. Right now, they say stage one, stage two, and phase three, or phase one, phase two, and phase three in the vaccine development. Now, do you think phase one is for testing the efficacy? Because no one wants to know first efficacy. They want to know whether the vaccine is safe to even inject for volunteers. Because if you inject a vaccine and if they die, that is very big unethical thing and also not an acceptable thing. So that is why first, in the first stage, they always do safety trials. That is whether they are having any side effects or not. So that is why phase one is for safety. And then in the phase two, once the safety is established, then they go for whether the vaccine is able to prove its efficiency, that is in fighting the coronavirus or any other disease that is intended to. And if it is fighting, then in phase three, they will expand both safety and efficacy along with larger trial. And then when it is successful in phase three, then it goes for commercial production. And even before phase one, phase two, and phase three, there is another stage called preclinical trials. So in preclinical trials, what they do is they first develop the vaccine and they test it on certain simulation techniques. Like in computer itself, they will test it whether it is causing any immune response or dangerous side effects. Then they give it to animals like rabbits, rats, or monkeys. And when they find they are safe, then they give it to humans in phase one level. So this is how the vaccine is developed. Okay, this is the vaccine development process. So the third statement is wrong here. And then we'll see the first and two. So here, even one and two are also wrong, because live attenuated vaccines mean they will modify the live virus itself. For example, coronavirus is there. They will modify the coronavirus to certain extent that it will not be that dangerous. And then they will inject into our body. then immune system will fight and produce antibodies. So that's why second one is also wrong. Conjugate vaccines is a special method where instead of injecting a dead virus or a modified weakened virus, they inject certain parts of the virus, like for example, certain proteins are there, or for sugar molecules are there that are part of coronavirus DNA. They will take that and they will inject into the body. Because they are also part of corona, body will generate certain immune response for that. So that is conjugate. So basically, I have interchanged the definitions of 1 and 2. So here the solution is D. None. So now why this is in context? Because in January first week, Serum Institute of India, which is right now also in news, this is a number one or the largest manufacturer of vaccines in the world. They just manufacture, they don't develop, okay? If someone develops a vaccine, they manufacture. So what they did is, they developed this pneumonia-related vaccine they have developed. This also they developed in a method called conjugate vaccine method. And this is more cheaper and most effective. That is why. And that is why it was in news. And now also it is in news because you all know there are certain different like 5 or 6 vaccines right now in phase 2 stage with respect to coronavirus. And all of them are using different methods. So that's why knowing the types of vaccines also is very important for us from both prelims and mains point of view for this year. So if you see this, like vaccines are basically used to generate immune response of the body. So how they do it? They do it on, or they develop the vaccine based on 3 parameters, like how your immune system responds to the germ. Second thing, who needs to be vaccinated? And third thing, what is the best technology? So they will consider these 3 components and then go for vaccine type, whether they have to go for live one or go for conjugate one, or there are other 2 types. So which type they have to go, that depends on these 3 parameters. Like what is the immune response? Second thing, to whom you are targeting? Third thing, what is the technology? So based on that, right now we have 4 types. And there are extra 2 types that also we'll discuss. So the first one is weakened live virus or live attenuated vaccines. This I've already discussed it. I'm not going to discuss this. So this is basically the same virus they will use, but they will weaken it. For example, coronavirus, they will weaken it in the lab and then they will inject it in the form of vaccine. But the problem with this is it cannot be used in cases where the immune system of the person is weak, because if it is strong, then they can generate immune response. But for the weak patients, this cannot generate that much. So that's why this is a disadvantage. Second thing, because it is a kind of weakened virus and virus has to live, it has to be stored in very low conditions, low temperature conditions. So that means you would need to have refrigerators and all to store. That's why these vaccines have certain limitations, which is not possible in India, like where you have certain diversity of climate. Second thing, conjugate. Conjugate, we already have seen. This is about modifying some component of the virus. For example, protein, sugar, or any casing around the germ. These are also called as recombinant or polysaccharide or conjugate vaccines. These are the different names. And these, again, this advantage is that this can even generate immune response for weak patients also. Like who have weak immune response. For example, diabetes patients usually have weak immune response. Even for them also, these kind of vaccines are most effective. But again, here also there is a problem. There is a problem that you need to give booster shots. That means you need to give 1 or 2, 3 times vaccines. Only then they will develop, because it is a only part of a germ. So that's why you need to give periodically. That is a problem, because in India you can't go for keep on giving vaccines, because some of them might take first dose and can't take second dose. So that is another problem. And the examples are hepatitis B and pneumonia vaccine right now. They are there. And then it is toxoid vaccines. So toxoid vaccines are basically every germ, that is bacteria or virus, basically when they get into the body, they produce certain toxins. And these toxins are the ones against which our body will generate certain antibodies and will fight. So basically what they do is, instead of virus, they take this toxin and they will inject into the body in the form of vaccine. So that is why it is called toxoid vaccines. Here also the same problem, you need to give multiple shots, but it is very easy to develop, because all you need is the toxin that is produced by the germ. And then there are 2 important vaccines that are being developed right now in with respect to coronavirus also. That is DNA vaccines, and next thing, recombinant vector vaccines. So DNA vaccines are very easy and inexpensive. So DNA is basically new technology that is developed. So in this, what they do is they modify the DNA part of a virus or any other microbe, which is not dangerous or even not coronavirus, but they will change the DNA of that in such a way that it replicates like corona, or it performs, it's seen as corona by the body. That way, body will generate immune response. So this is based on latest DNA technology. Then you have vector vaccines. So this is the vaccine technology that is being used by Oxford, AstraZeneca, that is right now developing the vaccine. So what they do is they basically pick up already an organism that we know. For example, we know flu, okay? We know SARS. So there was already a vaccine that was developed. So now they will modify that SARS or flu to have the properties of coronavirus, and then they will inject. Because you already have immune response for flu, you will develop immune response for coronavirus also. Here, basically what you're doing, you are using flu as a vector or a transporting body to inject this vaccine. That is why it is called vector-based vaccine. So vector is important here. That is how Oxford is developing right now this vaccine. And then this is about clinical stages. This we have already discussed. Kindly see once again. Genetic vaccine is something we have already discussed in the future vaccines category. So basically, either you modify DNA or RNA. And RNA is something right now Pfizer is trying to develop. Like there is a messenger molecule, messenger protein. So you'll modify the messenger and invoke immune response. And then viral vector, we already seen the Oxford AstraZeneca example. So kindly once again, read this slide carefully when you get this back, so that you'll have more clarity even with respect to the current developments. And these are very important science and technology terms that you need to know, not just from prudence, but especially from mains point of view also. Okay, don't ignore these kind of things. And also further reading, you have to know like which organization grants license for these clinical trials. It is DGCI. So kindly know what is the process and all. Now the seventh question. Consider the following cities that are in West Asia, which are recently in the news, and which of the above statements are present in Iraq. So basically you have to mark the cities that are present in Iraq. First one, Mosul. Second one, Jahedan. Third one, Kirkuk. And fourth one, Erbil. So which of the above statements are, or which of the above cities are present in Iraq? So kindly mark your answer. Then we'll see the right answer here. And all of these cities are constantly in the Hindu newspaper and in Hindu maps. So that's why I've given this. And this is also classical or typical way of UPSC asking about international affairs in exam. So here, basically, you might have all known like Jahedan is something related to Iran Chabahar link project. You would have already read in the recent past that Iran is on its own trying to construct this railway line from Chabahar to Jahedan, which is in the border of Iran and Afghanistan. So obviously Jahedan is in Iran. So if you eliminate the second option, then you have the answer here, because rest of the options you can automatically get eliminated. So it is 1, 3, and 4, Mosul, Kirkuk, and Erbil. All of these three cities are in Iraq. Last time they have asked about the cities that are in Syria, because at that time ISIS was being defeated in those cities. Like they have asked about Raqqa, whether Raqqa city was there in Syria or not, and other cities like Daesh and all. So that is why you have to know each and everything about West Asia. So now we'll see this in the form of maps and details. So here it is answered D, 1, 3 and 4. And so now I'll just give you the background information. So the first thing is what happened is basically, I'll show you the map and then I'll explain. So this you all know, like this is Iraq and this is Iran, right? So in January, in the first or January 2nd, US for the first time killed the top commander of Iran called Qasem Soleimani. Okay. So he killed them immediately. That was a very big escalation. Almost everyone thought there will be a war between Iran and US, and all the US forces, US has bases in Iraq, Syria, and also in Saudi and Gulf Peninsula. So all of them under threat from Iran. So that's why this was in news. So immediately what Iran did is, to countermeasure, as a countermeasure, Iran launched missiles on Erbil and also on Al-Assad air base of Iraq, because US forces are there in Iraq. So that's why these cities, Erbil, and then Baghdad, Tikrit, Kirkuk, and Basra. All of these cities, these were in news. So this is what the background. And if you go prior to that, you all know in 2015 there was a deal between Iran and US about nuclear thing, and then almost suddenly US came out and started imposing sanctions, and Iran trying to counter that, tried to threaten the ships that are passing through Gulf of Persia. Because of that, US escalated tensions. This is what went in happening the incident. So now we'll see this in statements, and then we'll go for the maps part. So as I said, the rockets of Iran have fell as a retaliation against Qasem Soleimani's killing in Balad Air Force Base of Iraq. And you have this maximum pressure policy. This is the one I was talking about. This is about US president coming out of and imposing more and more sanctions on Iran. So this is maximum pressure. And then you have strategic patience. Strategic patience is a policy adopted by EU, where it says Iran should act with restraint and US should stop imposing more and more sanctions, and both of them should come to certain deal. So this is a kind of policy adopted by EU, forcing Iran to abide by the treaty. And then Iran is adopting a policy called maximum resistance. So if it is maximum pressure, in opposite to that, Iran is adopting a style called maximum resistance. So try to know these terms, to which country it is related. Like maximum pressure, US, strategic patience, EU, maximum resistance for Iran. These are the news. And these are the areas where, or countries where US bases are right now based out of. This is also important to know. Like this is the map you can see. In Jordan, it has presence. In Syria, it has. And here it is Iraq. And then Kuwait, Bahrain, Qatar, UAE, Oman, and Yemen. You also need to what are the Gulf Cooperation Council countries here. And then you have Incirlik Air Base. This is NATO Air Base also in Turkey. This is also very important. And then you have Afghanistan. That is Bagram Air Base in near or in the outskirts of Kabul. This is also important from Afghanistan. So this is where US troops are present. And this I have explained. Like these rivers also important. Tigris and Euphrates go through Iraq and join in Persian Gulf. And this is the Kurdistan area. And here you have Erbil city, Mosul, Kirkuk, Tikrit, and then Baghdad. And finally the port city, Basra. So kindly remember these cities. These are also very important. These are part of Iraq. And then on the right side, you have Iran. And these are some other cities of same, like Iraq itself. This is the same replica map. Okay. This map I'm showing just for you so that you will have some visual image and so that you will be able to remember the cities. And these are the cities of Iran. So here, at least remember kindly where is Caspian Sea, whether Iran is border of Caspian Sea or not. And Tehran, where is Tehran? And some other cities like Bandar Abbas, which is very much in news. Jahedan, which is also in news. And then you have Chabahar, which is somewhere here. And then Gulf of Oman. And this Hormuz Strait. And then you have Persian Gulf and Indian Ocean bordering countries. All of these are important. So try to see these kind of maps. Or at least in the Google Maps and try to have a visual picture of them. Okay. So now finally, the eighth question. Consider the following statements with respect to different initiatives under Digital India. First one, Pragati is a multi-purpose and multimodal platform that is aimed at addressing common man's grievances and to monitor projects' progress. Second one, Umang has been developed as a single mobile platform to deliver major government services. Okay. And third one, DigiLocker is cloud-based platform to store the electronic copy documents, but not for issuance and verification of documents by government authorities. So kindly, once again, mark your answer and then we'll see the right solution for this. Okay, so if you have done here again, the third statement is something fishy here because it is saying that it is just to store the electronic copy documents. If it is just for storing it, you already have Google Drive. You already have OneDrive of Microsoft. Why you need government DigiLocker? Just think it from that common sense. It is basically government proposing it because it is something that government can verify and issue documents directly online. For example, you all know there is in Telangana MRTA application where you can store your license card, where you can store your bike registration card. So that way you don't need to carry physical documents. Whenever there is a check, you can directly show them. So this is a kind of DigiLocker concept. So similarly, government is planning to issue all your educational certificates, like graduation, 10th, all of them online by having an online verification. So this way you don't need to carry physical documents. It will be easy for you and for government also to check and admit in various processor purposes. So that's why this third one is strong. And second one, Umang. Umang is basically an all one app where you can find all the services of government. So that is why second one is correct. And third one is, you all know, Progressive. There is a big full form for this. So it basically used by Prime Minister even now to monitor all the important projects. So Prime Minister can directly do video conference with chief secretaries and district collectors and monitor the projects. And also it is used for common people to produce any grievances if they have and against those projects or certain policies of government. So that's why the first and two are correct here. So the answer is A, 1 and 2. So now we'll see the different applications that were launched under Digital India. This is also very important from prelims point of view, that you need to know what are the different applications. Umang we have discussed, Pragati we have discussed. So now we'll see ETAL, that is Electronic Transaction Aggregation and Analysis. So basically it is a kind of dashboard for real time view of what are the services that are being delivered by both states and local levels of government. So it's a kind of overall thing where you can see a dashboard kind of thing. How many schemes are, how many people have benefited, how many are not benefited, how many are in progress, these kind of thing. And then you have Jeevan Praman. So in this, basically a pensioner can directly provide his proof of existence, that too in the digital form. So he need not go each time to the office manually. So he can directly submit it digitally so that corruption can be eliminated. And then you have Darpan. So this is again a dashboard. This is right now in every ministry website where they will give complete data about project implementation. Okay. And then you have Digital Locker. This we have already seen. Okay. Where you can use it as drive and also for the government to verify and issue documents. This is important feature. And then these are the other features like e-Hastakar. Okay, this is like e-sign certificate where the documents can be signed by citizens and also certain government authorities. For example, MiSeva is there. They can directly certify and issue a document through this application. And kindly, when you get certain e-sign technology and all, try to know what it is. Because if you already know, that is okay. But if not, you have to know the concept also. Because last time there was a question on digital signature and it was very confusing. So you need to have crystal clarity on certain technology developments. And then you have GA Cloud. So this is about government offering services on the cloud, that is GA Cloud or Meghraj. And then you have National Knowledge Network. This is about linking all the educational institutions through broadband. So this way every educational institution can share their online resources. Now we are extending this even to Bhutan and other neighboring countries. This is related to education, National Knowledge Network. Then you have Wikispedia, that is maintained by MIT, that is Ministry of Electronics and IT. So they try to provide knowledge about government schemes, projects, policies, all of this in the Wikipedia kind of thing. So this is a basically Wikipedia of a government, that is Wikispedia. Okay. So these are all the schemes that are launched part of Digital India. Apart from schemes, now you need to further search what is Digital India, like how many Gram Panchayats are right now connected, whether digital Saksharat Bharat, that is digital literacy program, that is also part of Digital India scheme. So try to know what it is and then what are the other components, where the source of funds. If you remember in the previous classes, we have discussed about Universal Service Obligatory Fund, which is a cess that is imposed on telecom operators. It is collected and is provided for Digital India. So that also. So BharatNet. BharatNet is a sub-program of Digital India. So all these you have to know. So after covering this, if you do that research also, then your conceptual understanding in 360 degrees view will be completed.